Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8. We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to today. The Lord sent prophet after prophet, and Elijah and Elisha, miracle after miracle. And, of course, the miracles, they had two purposes. One, to build the faith of the godly, such as the sons of the prophets, the students of the schools of the prophets that Elijah started and Elisha continued. And there were other righteous people, not many in the 10 tribes to the north. The righteous people had headed south to Judah when they saw Jeroboam putting the two golden calves in Bethel and Dan and saying, "Here's your God, worship them." God's plural, I should say. The second purpose of the miracles was to bring a conscience back to the ungodly toward the Lord. Did they reach any? Well, I'm sure they reached a few, but we're going to see more miracles today. We ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 8, and it reads, "Then the king of Syria," this is probably the one and same as Ben-Hadad that we ran into in 1 Kings chapter 20, "Then the king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with his servants, saying, 'In such and such a place shall be my camp.'" Now, we're not talking about camping for the fun of it, leisure time, sit around the fire singing kumbaya and toasting marshmallows. He's establishing a camp within the borders of Israel to get a foothold in Israel. In other words, a camp from which they would launch attacks against the armies of Israel. And it seems like this battles or battles between the Syrians and Israel was kind of ongoing, and it was for many decades. And God would give Israel the victory and deliver them, but then Israel would again turn to their ungodly ways, fall back into idolatry, and the Lord would correct them with the Syrians. You know, God can strengthen your enemies against you in an effort to correct you. Verse 9, "And the man of God," this is Elisha, "sent unto the king of Israel," this being Jehoram, the son of Ahab, actually the second son of Ahab to hold the throne. The first died after 2 years on the throne, "saying, 'Beware that thou pass not such a place, for thither the Syrians are come down.'" And this doesn't quite translate what Elisha is telling Jehoram is exactly where the Syrians are trying to establish a foothold in Israel. He's telling Jehoram, don't let this area be unoccupied by troops from Israel. And one more verse, and we'll talk about it a little more, verse 10. "And the king of Israel sent to the place," he sent military troops to the place that Elisha told him, "which the man of God told him and warned him of, and saved himself there not once nor twice, but several times," in other words. And it seems to the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, like every time he starts to move to establish a camp in a certain area, Israel already has troops there. He begins to suspicion his own folks, thinking, I've got a spy that's telling Jehoram where we're going to establish the camp. and this warned him of and saved himself. Who was it who saved him? It certainly wasn't Elisha. It was Yahweh that saved them. Verse 11. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was sore troubled for this thing. How did Jehoram know where I was going to have my troops before I even moved the troops there? And he called his servants, this is Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, and said unto them, will ye not show me which of us is for the king of Israel? All right, this has gone on long enough now. Two or three times we've moved to establish a camp in Israel from which we can launch attacks. Every time Jehoram knows where we're going to be. I want to know which one of you is a spy and a traitor to me. Verse 12. And one of his servants said, none, my lord, O king, but Elisha, the prophet that is in Israel, telleth the king of Israel the words that thou speakest in thy bedchamber. In other words, Elisha knows what's going to be said in your bedroom. And I think the bedroom chosen here in that that's usually the most inner part of the house. A man, what he says to his wife, it should be in privacy in the bedroom. And the servant of Ben-Hadad is saying, Elisha knows what's going on in your bedroom, knows what you and your wife are doing before you even do it. Verse 13. And he said, this is Ben-Hadad, go and spy where he is, that I may send and fetch him. And it was told him, saying, behold, he is in Dothan. Dothan, if you translate it, means two wells. It's located about 12 miles north of Samaria, the capital of the 10 tribes of Israel at this time. Dothan, I think probably the first time that appears in God's word is in Genesis chapter 37, and that's the location or near there where the 12 patriarchs, the sons of Jacob, sold their brother Joseph to the Ishmaelites, and then he ended up in Egypt. Verse 14. Therefore sent he thither horses and chariots and a great host, a big army. And they came by night and compassed the city about. You know, I kind of question the wisdom of Ben-Hadad in pursuing this. Here he has someone that obviously God is prophesying through. He even knows what's going to be said in Ben-Hadad's own bedroom. And here Ben-Hadad is not letting it go. He's trying to locate Elisha, and what he's going to do with him when he catches him, I don't think he had thought out. Verse 15. And when the servant of the man of God, this obviously not Gehazi, who we covered in our last lesson, the one who was greedy and ended up with Naaman's leprosy, the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone forth. Behold, an host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots. And his servant said unto him, to Elisha, alas, my master, how shall we do? What are we going to do? We are surrounded by tens of thousands of the armies of the Syrians. Verse 16. And he answered, Elisha answered, fear not, for they that be with us are more than they that be with them. And here we see cool, calm, and collected is Elisha. And you know, that we can take a lesson, and how is it that he can be so cool, calm, and collected? It's called faith. It's called confidence in his heavenly Father. When you are on God's side, you are in the majority. Elisha knew that with God, all things are possible. But they're all his servants are all fearful, and what are we going to do? And Elisha's kind of saying, quick, grab your sword, let's go get them before they have a chance to get away. Verse 17, and Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes, this is his servant, that he may see, allow him to see into that dimension. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain upon which Dothan stood, was full of horses and chariots of fire round about Elisha. And this would be quite an awesome sight to see. You know, Elisha could have just told the servant and explained to him what was on the other side of that dimension that he could not see into. But there's a saying that seeing is believing. And the servant of Elisha had no reason not to believe what Elisha had told him. These horses and chariots, probably the same vehicles that Ezekiel described in Ezekiel chapter 1, where they were called the color of amber. If you translate that, take it back in your Strong's Concordance, and you'll find that that means that color amber should have been translated highly polished bronze. What we're talking about here, and the fire, of course, the propulsion, whatever form that is, you can bet it's not burning fossil fuel, of course. But, and you know, if this is the first time you've heard of this, there's a special study by Pastor Arnold Murray entitled Horses of the Bible. You might consider ordering that, or just put it on the back shelf and it'll come to you at a later point in time. Verse 18, and when they, the Syrians, came down to him, Elisha prayed unto the Lord and said, smite this people, I pray thee, with blindness. And he smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. God can open eyes, the eyes of the servant of Elisha, or he can close eyes, the eyes of the Syrian army. And, you know, if on a spiritual level, God can open your spiritual eyes or close your spiritual eyes. If he's given you eyes to see, don't ever forget to thank him. But just at the word of Elisha, God smote these tens of thousands of Syrian soldiers with blindness. Verse 19, this next part becomes rather humorous to me. It's one of my favorite places that proves that our Heavenly Father has a sense of humor. And Elisha said unto them, this is not the way, neither is this the city. This is not the, you're not going to find Elisha, the man you're looking for here. This isn't Dothan. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom ye seek. But he led them to Samaria. And here we see the sense of humor that our Heavenly Father, they're looking for Elisha, but now they're all blind. And Elisha says, the man you're looking for isn't here. Let me lead you to him. And what does he do? He takes them right smack dab in the middle of the capital of their enemies, the Israelites. I can just see, too, Elisha, you know, he led them into Samaria. They're blind. So I can just see Elisha, taking one of the Syrians by the hand and saying, okay, you guys line up, and everybody grab the man in front of his hand, and here they go traipsing across the desert, going into Samaria with Elisha leading them the way. The Syrians are probably thinking, boy, we sure are lucky that we ran into this nice guy that's going to take us to Elisha. And they didn't realize it was Elisha, and he was leading them into the capital of the enemy. Verse 20, and it came to pass when they were come into Samaria that Elisha said, Lord, open the eyes of these men, that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw. And behold, they were in the midst of Samaria, right smack dab in the middle of Israel's capital, the enemy's headquarters. And the king of Israel, this is Jehoram at the time, said unto Elisha, when he saw them, "My father," this is an honorary title that means counselor or master. Pharaoh himself even called Joseph father at one point, meaning counselor. "Shall I smite them? Shall I smite them?" You can almost hear the excitement in Jehoram's voice as he repeats the question twice. He's excited that the enemy has been delivered into his hand. 22, "And he answered," Elisha answering the king of Israel, "Thou shalt not smite them. Wouldest thou smite those whom thou hast taken captive with thy sword and with thy bow?" You don't smite or kill prisoners of war. "Set bread and water before them that they may eat and drink and go to their master." And I think this serving a lesson to the Syrians that no power on earth can stand against the power of Yahweh. Verse 23, "And he prepared great provision for them. And when they had eaten and drunk, he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syria came no more into the land of Israel." And these bands were the marauding bands we talked about in our last lecture. You remember Naaman, the leper general of the Syrian army? The marauding bands had captured a maid of Israel, and they made her a servant in the house of Naaman, a housemaid, if you will. But this does not mean that the armies of the king of Syria would be back, and very soon, verse 24. "And it came to pass after this that Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, gathered all his host," I emphasize the word all, "and went up and besieged Samaria." And if that's not bad enough that the Syrian armies have besieged Samaria, there's a severe famine going on in the land at the time. God chastising Israel for their unrighteous ways. And in Leviticus 26 and Deuteronomy 28, we have the blessings and the curses of God. You can do things his way and receive his blessings, or you can go against him and receive his curses. Israel is receiving their share of curses at this time. Verse 25, "And there was a great famine in Samaria, and behold, they besieged it, the Syrian armies, until an ass's head was sold for 80 pieces of silver, and the fourth part of a cab of dove's dung for 5 pieces of silver." And this really loses it. When a city was besieged by an army, it was cut off from the outside world. Nobody came in, nobody went out. And so the famine was already on, but there was no way to get additional supplies into Samaria. And what this verse is saying is it got so desperate for food that an ass's head, which would not have very much meat on it at all, was sold for 80 pieces of silver. And a cab, this is the only place this word appears in the King James Version Bible, it equals about 1 quart English measure. The dove's dung is a subject of controversy. Some people think that it was actually dove's dung, and the use for that, of course, would be fertilizer. But if you're already out of food, to buy something to fertilize the ground with so you could plant a seed in it, and then the plant would grow and mature and then finally produce fruit, you probably would have already died of starvation by the time that process had time to take place. The Smith's Bible Dictionary states that this dove's dung is a chickpea. And the Strong's Concordance simply says it's some type of vegetable. But the point is that the food, that what there is of it, has gotten extremely expensive. Verse 26. And as the king of Israel, this is Jehoram, was passing by upon the wall, there cried a woman unto him, saying, Help my lord, O king. Verse 27. And he said, If the Lord do not help thee, whence shall I help thee? Out of the barn floor or out of the wine press? Question. What he's saying here is, I can't help you with food out of the threshing floor or drink from the wine press. He's kind of laying the blame for this on God. Why are you asking me? I'm just the king. Ask God to ease your suffering. 28. And the king said unto her, What aileth thee? And she answered, This woman said unto me, Give thy son that we may eat him today, and we will eat my son tomorrow. This was prophesied by our Heavenly Father as well. Leviticus chapter 26, verse 29, and Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 53, and the verses preceding that. God says, if you walk contrary to me, I will walk seven times contrary to you. And it will get to the point where you're going to be so hungry that you'll eat your own children. It has come to pass. What the one lady is saying, let's kill your son and boil him and eat him today, and we'll kill my son and boil him and eat him tomorrow. Turning to cannibalism is how desperate the people had become. Did they turn to God and ask him to relieve them? No, they turned to an unrighteous king, son of Ahab. Verse 29, the woman continues, So we boiled my son and did eat him. And I said unto her on the next day, Give thy son that we may eat him. And she hath hid her son. She backed out on the agreement after we ate my son. And anytime you think of a famine, if you're like me, your mind races to Amos chapter 8. Verse 11, where it states that the famine of the end times is not for bread or water. The famine of the end times is for hearing the word of God. And the famine is on in this time. Verse 30. And it came to pass, when the king heard the words of the woman, that he rent his clothes, and he passed by upon the wall. And the people looked, and behold, he had sackcloth within upon his flesh. The sackcloth, a sign of mourning or humbling himself. Elisha had probably told Jehoram that if the people would change their ways and return with all their heart to the Lord, that he would save them. Jehoram is feeling as though he had done his part by putting on this little bit of a show. Let me ask you, did he go into an inner chamber and put on sackcloth? No. He put on sackcloth, and he rent his clothes, first of all, in a public place on the wall. Then he put on the sackcloth on the wall. You see, what he was doing was to be seen of men. He was trying to please the people of Samaria. He wasn't really sincerely repenting and seeking reprieve from the Lord. And at this point, he's feeling a little bit like God has failed him, and he fulfilled his part, and he's going to fly into a rage and say, God, do it now. Verse 31. And he said, God do so and more also to me, if the head of Elisha, the son of Shaphat, shall stand on him this day. I'm going to find Elisha, and I'm going to have his head removed, because he's the one who told me that if we would repent and return to the Lord, that we would be relieved from this terrible situation we're in. Verse 32, but Elisha sat in his house, and the elders of the city, sat with him. And the king sent a man from before him. But before the messenger came to him, he said to the elders, Elisha saying to the elders, see ye how this son of a murderer, he's referring to Ahab, and Ahab and Jezebel, his wife, certainly fit the bill of being murderers, hath sent to take away mine head. Look, when the messenger cometh, shut the door, and hold him fast at the door. Is not the sound of his master's feet behind him? And what he's saying here is that when the messenger arrives, hold the door shut against the messenger. And soon after will come Jehoram. Verse 33, and while he yet talked with them, the elders, behold, the messenger came down unto him. And he said, this is actually the king, and I'll just explain in a moment, behold, this evil or calamity is of the Lord. What or why should I wait for the Lord any longer? Why should I have hope that the Lord is going to deliver us? And check out this word messenger. The Moffat Bible, if you have one, correctly translate this rather than the messenger came down, it's the king came down. You see, in the Hebrew language, the word king is M-E-L-E-K, transliterated, Melech. Messenger is Malak, M-A-L-A-K. In the Masora, the Aleph is incorrectly added, making it, or I should say, from the Masora, the translations, and a leaf, which is equivalent to our A, was incorrectly added, making the word messenger instead of king. And when we get to chapter 7, verses 2 and 17, will plainly be that it was the king who came, not a messenger. Let's go ahead and start into chapter 7. Things are really, really bad. Then Elisha said, hear ye the word of the Lord. This is to the king of Israel, Jehoram. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure, that's equivalent to our peck today, a fine flour will be sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel, in the gate of Samaria, the gate, not only the place of judgment or court, but also the marketplace. What Elisha's prophesying here is that by this time tomorrow, in other words, within 24 hours, the price of food will be back to normal. A peck of fine flour will sell for a shekel, two measures of barley, which is poor man's bread in hard times, but I should say in hard times, but in good times, it's what they feed the livestock, the horses and the cattle. No more starvation. The famine is going to be over. Verse 2. Excuse me. Then a lord on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God and said, behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be? And he, Elisha, said, behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but shall not eat thereof. And this kind of loses it in the translation. What the servant of the king is doing is, he said this very sarcastically. And what he's doing is mocking Genesis chapter 7, verse 11. And what he's mocking the prophecy of Elisha and saying that's not possible that that happened. And Elisha said not only is it going to happen and it's very possible, but and it is going to happen, but you are not going to be able to eat thereof. You're going to continue starving. Verse 3, and there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate, and they said one to another, why sit we here until we die? Now this kind of switched gears on us, so don't get lost. What this is doing is explaining how it's going to come to pass that in 24 hours that a measure of fine flour shall sell for a shekel and two measures of barley for one shekel in Samaria. Now, you see, lepers would not have been allowed in a city in Israel. They were considered unclean. And what they're doing is they're sitting at the gate of the city. And why are they there? They're begging, but they're rationalizing among themselves, and they say, you know, the people of Samaria are starving to death. They don't have anything to give beggars, so if we sit here, we're also going to starve to death. Verse 4, if we say, they continue reasoning among themselves, we will enter into the city, which would be forbidden, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit still here, we die also. Either way, we're going to starve to death. Now therefore come, and let us fall unto the host, the army of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall but die. We're going to starve to death if we stay here anyway. And you know, the Syrians were a little more tolerant of the leprous people than the people of Israel. You remember in our last lecture, Naaman was still the general of the army. The condition or the disease that he had didn't prohibit him from serving in his capacity as a general in the armies of Syria. So they're thinking, well, if we go down to the Syrians, maybe they'll have some compassion upon us and give us something to eat. If they kill us, well, we will but die. And I guess that beats starving to death. You know, starving to death is a terrible, very slow death. And they're saying, wouldn't it be better if it just came to an end by a sword if the Syrians killed us? Well, we'll come back and see how one measure of fine flour will sell for a shekel and two measures of barley for a shekel in Samaria. Will the prophecies of Elisha come to pass? The prophecies of God always do. Don't miss the next lecture. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free. The CD is free. No shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's Word in a positive format. Throwing out negative about others serves no purpose, and we simply won't do it. We'll let God's Word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're studying via the internet somewhere around the world and unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address, quite all right, to mail your questions in. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the 800 number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Talk to Him. Make time each day. I really feel like you don't have a lot of competition these days. Kind of like things were in Israel. Wasn't anybody talking to God and asking Him to deliver them. They were just suffering and continued to suffer. Do things God's way, receive His blessings. Don't do things His way, receive His cursings. The choice is always yours. We do come to you, Father, united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their needs. Families of lost loved ones, Father, we ask that you comfort, send the comforter to be with them. Illnesses, Father, we ask that touch of healing. And as always, we remember our military troops, Father, who are in harm's way around the world. Watch over them. We're always careful to give you the praise. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal. In Jesus' precious name, amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks. First up today, we have Chet in Maine. My daughter committed suicide. She had mental illness and was on medication for depression since the last 10 years. I pray she goes to heaven and finds Jesus. We all have talked to her trying to get her into the Word of God. I'd like to know if she has a chance to go to heaven. Does the Bible speak of this? Well, everyone, when they die, goes to paradise, Chet. Now, you do need to understand that there are two sides of the gulf. And if you don't have a clue what I'm talking about, make a note of Luke chapter 16. There's a place where the righteous people go, such as Lazarus of Luke 16. And there's a place where the unrighteous go, such as the rich man of Luke chapter 16. God knows the hearts and minds of all of His children. And He knows the difficulties, the illnesses that people have. And I'm certain that He takes that into consideration in judging. You can rest assured, Chet, that He's a very fair judge. And what we all get exactly what we deserve. Mathilda in Illinois. Let's see. Arnold said not so long ago in answer to someone's question that your soul flies away when you die. Question, do souls fly away or how do they go back to our Heavenly Father? And I think what he was referring to or explaining probably was Psalms 90 verse 10, which states that we all live for 70 or 80 years and then we die and our soul flies away. And that's exactly what happens. Ecclesiastes chapter 12 verses 6 and 7 tell us that when we die, the flesh returns to the earth from which it came and our spirit returns to the Father from whence it came. That does not refer to the rapture there. Martha in Georgia. Hope all is well. Thanks for all you do. Everything is very well. Thank you for your concern, and we appreciate your continued prayers for the chapel, but everything's rocking along very nicely. When I introduce people to Watch Shepherd's Chapel, would that also be a form of planting seeds? I know the word, but I can't always quote it. Well, yes, telling someone where they can hear the word of God taught chapter by chapter, verse by verse, would be considered planting seeds. And you know, it's not critical that everyone be able to quote scripture from memory. It's important that a teacher of the word obviously have the ability to call scripture, which is, in my opinion, a gift from God. But Yes, what you're doing, telling people about the program, is planting seeds. We are a many-membered body, and we all need to work and strive, every single one that we can reach out and their heart return to the Father is one less that will see the fire along with Satan. Betty in Florida, when we are to allow the Holy Spirit to speak through us, referring to God's elect, to the Antichrist, will it be like the gibberish people are praying today and calling it the Holy Spirit? Absolutely not. Everyone will understand, which is the case of Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and the following verses. The disciples didn't need an interpreter to interpret the gibberish that one of them was speaking. Everyone, and there were people there from all over the world that spoke many different languages, understood what the disciples were saying. Now that, friends, is the evidence of the Holy Spirit. That's the same language, the tongue, that the elect will speak when they are delivered up before the Antichrist. Therefore, everyone will be able to understand. Ethel in Illinois. 2 Chronicles 10:19 states, "And Israel rebelled against the house of David unto this day. Is this the cause of Israel's status as of today?" Well, the scripture you're referring to was at the time of Solomon's son Rehoboam. And it was because of Solomon's falling into idolatry that the nation would be split. And that happened under his son Rehoboam, and the 10 tribes went north. They went after the captivity to the Assyrians, I should say, they went north over the Caucasus Mountains, became known as Caucasian peoples of the world, settled in Europe, and many migrated on further to Canada and the United States. So, when you say the cause of Israel's status today, you need to understand the parable of the fig tree, part of which is Jeremiah chapter 24. And you learn there that in Judah today there are good figs and there are bad figs, naughty figs, as they're referred to in Jeremiah 24, all part of the parable of the fig tree that Jesus said in Matthew 24, learn the parable of the fig tree. Joel in Illinois, how are we supposed to pray for our leaders when their morals and priorities are in direct contrast to our own? Thank you for all you do and your staff, and thank you for remembering the staff. We have a very hard-working group of people. Pray God will change their minds. Pray God will change their morals to where they are acting responsibly and righteously. Howard in Georgia, after the sixth trump, will the people that Satan tricks into believing he is the Holy One, Jesus Christ, will they go down with him or will they qualify for the millennium? Well, when you say go down, I assume you're meaning go down into the lake of fire. Or you might mean go down into the abyss of Revelation 20, I'm not sure. Either way, everyone qualifies for the millennium. No one goes into the lake of fire until the great white throne judgment, which you can read about in Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 and the following verses. And then the eternity starts. You either go into the lake of fire with Satan or you go into the lake to the eternity with your heavenly Father, Revelation chapter 21 and 22. I think this is Ricky or Ruby, I can't read your writing, of Missouri. My friend said that a man and a woman could marry each other and it would be legal. Is this true if they didn't use a pastor to marry them? Well, now that depends on what state you are living in. There is something in many states referred to as common law marriage, and that quite simply stated means that if a couple has lived together for 7 years, I believe it is in our state here, that they're considered married, and that's called a common law marriage. Now, we always caution people, though, that in the event that there is a possibility that children will be born, we encourage people to obtain a civil marriage license. Why? Well, it's a legal document, and it protects, for example, if the marriage does not work out, it holds the husband responsible for helping pay for the children's upbringing, and that's the way it should be. You are responsible for bringing the children into the world. If you decide to leave your wife, that does not end your responsibility as far as making sure the children have food on the table and are cared for. So obtain a civil license if children are a possibility. It protects the rights of the children. Frida in California. My question is, do you have to be baptized? You see, I'm 92 years old and I can't let water in my ears and I'm short of breath. Is there a way around this, because I would really like to have this done? I'm so proud to be able to watch and listen to you and Pastor Dennis. You're both very good, and I really missed watching you for a long time. I changed TV companies, but now I'm back where I can see you both. The work that all of you do is very much needed. You two call it like it is, and I'm learning a lot from both of you. Well, I'm honored that a 92-year-old can say that she is learning a lot from us. And Frida, God bless you. You've had a long life, and you know, baptism probably not a salvation issue that many people teach that it is. They look at John chapter 3, verse 5, which states that you have to be born of water to enter the kingdom of God. They take that to mean baptism. It's not baptism. It means that you're born in the flesh, as opposed to the fallen angels who refuse to be born in the flesh. They are not going to enter the kingdom of God. And Frida, you know, Jesus was baptized and he was our example. So, you know, what I would do if I were you is I would have any Christian can take a handful of water. It doesn't have to be from a creek. It can be out of a sink, a kitchen faucet. Take a handful of water and pour it over your head. Just a few drops of water is all that's necessary. God's very intelligent. And then have them say, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we baptize you in the name of Jesus Christ. And that would take care of it, Frida, and that's what I would do if I were you. God, we do that quite frequently. People who are afraid of the water would qualify, or someone who has a medical condition such as you, that you cannot get water in your ears, such as being submersed in a pool of water. So God's very intelligent, and that will do it. Jeremy from Iowa. In the first earth and heaven age, were we angels? Thanks for you and your staff. Again, thanks for remembering the staff. Yes, man in spirit bodies only during the first and heaven and earth age. There was no flesh man. Now, there was flesh, and we read about the dinosaurs in Job chapter 40. They're called behemoth in the King James Version Bible, but there were dinosaurs on earth. They existed. when, in the first, in earth and heaven age, but there was no flesh man at that point in time. And we have Andrew from North Carolina. Could you please help me out with something I thought I heard Pastor Murray say? When you say the name Isaac, you also say Saxon, because Isaac means Saxon in of the Anglo, that is to say, such as the Anglo-Saxon people. Could you please straighten out my mind on this? I hope I'm not running two things together. Pastor Arnold was an awesome teacher. You and your staff are top-notch also. Thank you. And Andrew is at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, airborne. And we thank you, Andrew, for serving our country. Isaac, you're asking about what the name means. If you translate it, it means laughter. Why? Because when the angel of the Lord told Sarai that she was going to give birth to a son, she was 90 years old, and she laughed within herself that she could be a mother at such a late time in life. Now, what you are kind of confusing, or what you heard Pastor Murray talking about, was the descendants of Isaac. They are called Isaac's sons, and that is where the name Saxon comes from. That's what you're confusing. God bless you, and thanks again for serving in our country. Go airborne. Joan, and I don't know where Joan's from, please tell us about how it will be on the day that Jesus returns. Will it be scary? Well, if you wait for him, it will be wonderful. If you find yourself and you're deceived into worshiping the Antichrist, then it could be kind of scary when Jesus returns. Why? Because you're already worshiping this guy who claims to be Jesus Christ, and you're going to realize you've been worshiping the wrong Messiah. You're going to have been worshiping the Antichrist. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, and people will be praying for mountains to fall on them. Why? Because they're going to be so ashamed that they sat in a church pew for decade after decade, and then they ended up worshiping the wrong Christ. They're deceived. Don't be deceived. Robert in Tennessee, after the six-day creation, who, can you please help explain this? After the six-day creation, who did the races worship? When Adam and Eve's children left out and married into tribes, who did these people worship? In other words, when did God, our Creator, become known to the earliest of human mankind? Well, God said in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, to the angels, he said, let us make man in our image. And then he said to those people, the six-day creation, that for them to be fruitful and multiply. So they knew, they may have not known who he was, but they knew he existed because he communicated with them. He said, be fruitful and multiply. The earliest that he spoke with Adam and Eve, Genesis chapter 2, the first commandment that he gave to Adam and Eve, you'll find in Genesis chapter 2, verses 16 and 17, where he told them, of every tree in the Garden of Eden, you can freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, you are not to partake of that. He commanded them not to do that. That was the cause of the fall of man. Karen in North Carolina, were the Cherokee Indians from the six-day creation or the Adamic race? Well, the Adamic race means ruddy complected, means able to show blood in the face. Native American Indians, in my opinion, are descendants of the six-day creation. And when God had made them, in the last verse of chapter 1 of Genesis, he looked upon all he created, and it was good. Heidi, it was very good. Heidi in Arkansas, if it was bad that the fallen angels impregnated women, why isn't it bad that the Holy Spirit impregnated Mary? Well, the first wasn't in God's plan. The fallen angels refused to be born of woman. They came to earth against God's plan that all be born of woman in this, the second earth and heaven age. And they knew and took women, and children resulted. They were freaks, giants, freaks of nature. They were giants. The second, you mentioned, the holy conception of Mary, the second was God's plan of salvation for the world. There's a huge difference. Donald, in Texas, in 2 Kings, how was Isaiah killed? Well, you won't find in 2 Kings the death of Isaiah recorded, and nowhere in the King James Version Bible will you find the death of Isaiah, but tradition, and again I say tradition, don't misquote me, states that when Isaiah was 90 years old, he was sawn in sunder, meaning in two, in the trunk of a carob tree by order of Manasseh, who was probably the most evil, wicked king of Israel, or Judah, I should say, that ever existed. That's by the tradition of men. I'm out of time. I love you a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's word in depth. It makes God's day when he looks down and he sees you studying the letter he wrote to you, the Bible. Blessings always follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others of our brothers and sisters who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important this, though, you stay in his word every day, and Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Ezekiel. What a fantastic study, this Book of Ezekiel. The Book of Ezekiel that covers, if you would, those vehicles, those circular discs. In the Hebrew, it states very clearly that that whirlwind with the color amber traced back to the Hebrew, highly polished bronze. What an exciting thing that God's word informs us on all things. Ezekiel, one of my favorite prophets of the Bible, probably more written, not probably, but absolutely more written on what will happen in the millennium age than even the book of Revelation. Ezekiel guiding you through it, what God will expect at the final battle, Armageddon and Haman Gog, recorded in this great prophecy. I know you're going to enjoy it, the book of Ezekiel.
Gravett, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right. Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Praise God. Let's get back into our Father's work. What are we going to do tonight? I'm going to have to put an appendix on the subject, Satan's downfall. In the last lecture, we, through Ezekiel,